Welcome to TAB Virtual, the online broadcast of Sunday morning service at the historic Tabernacle Baptist Church in West Palm Beach, Florida. Our pastor is the Reverend Gerald D. Kistner, and our assistant pastor is the Reverend Kevin L. Jones. We are glad you chose to worship with us today, and we invite you to subscribe to our YouTube channel. If you are in search of a church home, Pastor Kistner and the members of Tabernacle would love to have you become part of our Tabernacle family. The historic Tabernacle Baptist Church. For over 127 years, we are God's church on the hill, serving Christ. Join us now as we offer our highest praise and worship to God.
Bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Oh,
bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Bless that wonderful name of Jesus.
I'll bless that wonderful name of
Jesus.
Oh,
bless that wonderful name of Jesus.
Oh, I'll bless that wonderful name of
Jesus. No other name I know.
There's healing in the name of
Jesus.
Oh, there's healing in the name of
Jesus.
Yes, there's healing.
No other name I know.
Then there's power in the name of
Jesus.
Yes, there's power
in the name of Jesus.
Tell you there's power
in the name of Jesus.
No other name.
No other name I know.
Oh, can't nobody do me like Jesus. Can't nobody
do me like the Lord.
Oh, can't nobody
do me like Jesus.
Yes,
He's my friend.
Oh, He healed my body. Told me to run. Yes, He healed. Told me to run on. Yes, He healed.
Told me to run on.
Can't nobody do me like Jesus.
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 Can't nobody
do me like the Lord.
Do me like the Lord.
Can't
nobody
do me like Jesus.
Do me like Jesus.
Oh, He's my friend.
Good morning, my sisters and brothers. We're just so happy that you have chosen to join us with TAB Virtual on this wonderful fourth Sunday. Also, the Sunday that we'll be commissioning our workers in the peace, our members who have given of themselves to be those justice ministry team members. And so we're going to be commissioning them during the service. But it's a great day to worship, and we're so happy that you've joined us. Won't you join me for our call to worship? Please stand. Oh God, my God, early will I seek thee. My soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longeth for thee in a dry and thirsty land where no water is, to see thy power and thy glory as I have seen thee in the sanctuary. Because thy loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise thee. Thus will I praise thee while I live. I will lift up my hands in thy name. My soul followeth hard after thee. Thy right hand upholdeth me. Amen.
Good morning. Let us pray. God of creation, once again, we love you and we thank you for this day. We thank you for the power and the presence of your Spirit. In the midst of these difficult times, it's still good to know that you are God and you sit high and reach low. So God, we thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for being a God of mercy and grace, and we thank you that you've allowed us another opportunity to gather in your name. So as always, God, we invite your presence. We invoke your Spirit to come, to fall fresh on all that is said and done on this morning, that you may gain glory. God, we pray that you will be with the singing, the praying, the giving, and the preaching. That if one does not know you on today, they will say, I yield, I yield. And particularly on today, we thank you for these Justice Ministry team members and their faithfulness, and we just pray, God, that you continue to strengthen them and be with us throughout this worship experience. It's in Jesus' name we do pray. Let all the people of God who love God say amen. Thank you.
My brothers and sisters, you recall that Reverend Jones has been really talking over the last couple of weeks, trying to recruit some more Justice Ministry team members. And we're still putting that call out. We still need more of you who would say, I want to put my faith walk into practice. On this Sunday, we're so happy that we do have three who have dedicated themselves to becoming Justice Ministry team members. Yeah, give them a nice round of applause. These are the Trinity Three, but we want to have the Sanctified Seven. So we need at least four more of you who are viewing this service, that you would be encouraged and inspired. The work that they do is so important. We are a big part of the peace movement. We are doing so many wonderful things, the wage theft, the civil citations, the homelessness, the community IDs, the police community relations, all of these things. And in these terrible times, justice is something that we need to be really on the case with. And so these three, I'm going to ask them to stand up, and I want you all to give them another round of applause. You can look at the people. You can look at the people. Amen. Amen. They have just decided to go beyond and above the usual work of the church. And the church is not just in the walls, but justice must be done outside of the walls. And so we're so thankful for these three. And we hope by their example that someone out there in the viewing audience or the listening audience might decide that they too want to join them and to help them out. And so at this time, we're going to have our commissioning and our sending out. You'll see the words on the screen, and you can repeat them as you read them. I'll read the first paragraph, and then I'll tell you which part that you all have to read. Amen? In the name of the divine Trinity, let us pray. God, you have called us into being through love. You have joined us to one another in love. How good and pleasant it is when your people dwell together in unity. Our lives are but a breath, but our breaths are drawn from your divine spirit. You have created us as walking paradoxes, specks of dust, and divine image bearers. We are constantly restless until we rest in you. Peace of Christ to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's give him another round of applause. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. You may be seated.
Hello, my brothers and sisters. Once again, it's now preaching time, and there's a word from the Lord. If you can make your way to the gospel according to Luke, the 7th chapter, I'm going to read verses 18 through 23. Luke 7, 18 through 23. I'm reading from the New International Version of the Sacred Writ. You can follow with whatever translation you have. And the record reads as follows. John's disciples told him about all these things. Calling two of them, he sent them to the Lord to ask, "Are you the one who was to come, or should we expect someone else?" When the men came to see Jesus, they said, "John the Baptist sent us to you to ask, 'Are you the one who was to come, or should we expect someone else?'" At that very time, Jesus cured many who had diseases, sicknesses, and evil spirits, and gave sight to many who were blind. So he replied to the messengers, "Go back and report to John what you have seen and heard. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is preached to the poor. Blessed is the man who does not fall away on account of me." May the Lord add a blessing to the reading, the hearing, and the doing of his holy word. And if I had to place a subject on this morning's text, the subject would simply be "When Things Fall Apart." When things fall apart. Pray with me, saints. Heavenly Father, we love you and we thank you for this day. We thank you for the power and the presence of your Spirit. Now, God, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to thy sight, O Lord, my strength and redeemer. It's in Jesus' name we do pray. Let all the people of God who love God say amen. When things fall apart, when things fall apart. Pastor Kisner, in 1958, Chinua Achebe penned a novel entitled Things Fall Apart. It has been translated into 50 languages and has sold over 10 million copies. It follows Okonkwo, a renowned warrior from the fictional village called Igbo in the 20th century Eastern Nigeria. The book depicts how a culturally rich and well-governed society was de-established by the arrival of Christian missionaries and British colonists. Although Okonkwo was a flawed man, he attempts to confront the forces, transforming his village, but it was to no avail. And ultimately, in a final act of rebellion, Okonkwo ended up taking his own life. Things Fall Apart was an important literary piece. For the first time, a novel was written from the African lens or from the African's perspective. You see, saints, up to that point, white authors had told the story about missionaries coming to Africa and how they came to save and clean up a barbaric people. And when you read this book, you understand that there was a history. There was culture, there was laws, religion, and a way of life that had already been established. But after the British came, unfortunately, things fell apart. And if truth be told, my brothers and sisters, things have fell apart in this country. Foreign governments' influence on elections are now welcomed. Democracy is being compromise. Racism is stoked at every turn. And a segment, I'll say once again, a segment of the evangelical church now supports immorality. It has recently been brought to our attention that our president knew full well of the implications of COVID-19 and failed to take action. And now there are even horrendous reports of increased hysterectomies taking place in ICE facilities. I tell you, my brothers and sisters, things have fell apart. For many of our brothers and sisters, things are falling apart in their personal lives. Loved ones are being lost to this COVID-19, and financial futures are at stake. Life as we once knew it is no more. And as we engage our text for this morning, we find ourselves on the heels of two impressive healings by Jesus. If you read the text, you will find out that the Lord was being used in a mighty way. In Capernaum, there was a centurion whose servant was sick.
And when he heard Jesus was in town, he sent some Jewish elders to go see Jesus, see if he would come heal his servant. The Jewish elders, they vouched for Jesus, or they vouched for the centurion and told Jesus that he was a decent man and that he had actually built the synagogue for the people. As Jesus started to make way to his house, Jesus was met by some of the other friends of the centurion, and they told Jesus that the centurion didn't feel like he was worthy to be in the presence of Jesus, so he didn't want Jesus to come to his house. But the good thing is that he knew that if Jesus would just speak a word, his servant would be healed. And saints, Jesus was impressed by the centurion, and he told the crowd gathered, "I have not found such great faith in Israel." And by the time the centurion's friends had made it home, the servant was healed. Then Jesus made his way to Nain, and he approached the city gate, and while he was approaching the city, there was a funeral procession taking place. A mother, a widow, had lost her only son. And when Jesus saw this mama crying, something touched him. Jesus approached the mother, and he told her, "Don't cry." He made his way to the coffin, touched the coffin, and said, "Young man, I say to you, get up." And the text informs us that the young man got up and began to talk and went home with his mother. So saints, as you could imagine, those that witnessed these events were in awe and praised God. They said a great prophet had appeared among them, and they were grateful that God was about helping God's people. And parenthetically, my brothers and sisters, we should always remember, just like God was willing to help his people then, God is willing to help God's people right now. So once again, the talk about Jesus has spread throughout Judea and the surrounding country. But what we need to understand this morning is that some of the witnesses present were disciples of John the Baptist. John the Baptist was on lockdown at this time. And somebody may ask the question, "Reverend, why was John the Baptist in jail?" You see, saints, being the prophet that he was, John had told Herod the Tetrarch that he was wrong because basically he had stole his brother Herod Antipas' wife. And not only should I mention that, but did I forgot to mention that this young lady was both of their nieces? That's a whole nother subject. But if it wasn't bad enough, John the Baptist called him out because in Jewish law, a man couldn't marry a brother's wife while he was still alive. So how did Herod respond? Herod responded by putting him or sentencing him to prison. So I'm sure when John's disciples entered into that prison to visit him, I'm sure they figured John would like to hear about the ministry of Jesus. Maybe, just maybe, this would encourage him. Maybe this would lift up his spirits. Pastor Kilsner, something was different about John the Baptist on this day. John, I could imagine, as they were telling him about the amazing things, the amazing ministry that Jesus was performing, I would imagine that John the Baptist was distant and preoccupied, like something was on his mind. John the Baptist didn't even acknowledge what they relayed to him. He didn't have any comment. All he instructed them to do was to ask Jesus. "I need y'all to do one thing. Ask Jesus, are you the one to come? Or should we expect someone else?" Things were falling apart in the life and in the spirit of John the Baptist. But saints, let's see how the Lord responds. When things fall apart, the first thing you need to remember is that we all struggle with doubt. Yeah, there are times when all of our faith is tested. Now, saints, just to backtrack a little bit, I need y'all to really remember who I'm talking about. We're not talking about some sunshine Christian, Reverend Kisner. We're not talking about some fake follower of Jesus. No, we're talking about John the Baptist, the one whose address was the wilderness, the one who nourished his appetite with locusts and honey. We're talking about John the Baptist, who was a prophet, who was a cousin of Jesus. And matter of fact, the text tells us when they both were in their mother's womb, John knew it was something different about Jesus. You see, when Mary went to visit her cousin Elizabeth, who was also with child, the text tells us that John leapt in his mother's womb. We're talking about John the Baptist, who stated that he was the one pointing to the one, that he was the one who prepared the way for Jesus. He was the one who came as a witness to the light. He was the one who baptized Jesus and stated that he was not worthy to untie the sandals of Jesus. We're talking about John the Baptist. When John first reunited with Jesus, he told those gathered, "Look, here comes the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." John knew Jesus, and Jesus knew John. But right now, John was having trouble. John was doubting. I can't reiterate this enough. I don't want anyone to miss this. This was John the Baptist with all of this history with Jesus, who still in this moment, as he languished in jail, he wanted this question relayed to Jesus: are you the one? Or should we expect someone else? John the Baptist, saints, he went from the wilderness to prison. He went from freedom to confinement. And now he was bound in chains. His predicament had caused him to doubt. His predicament had caused him to lose hope and struggle with his faith. Those long nights on lockdown had begun to quietly break his spirit. So he wanted some affirmation. He wanted to know if Jesus was truly the Messiah, was Jesus the anointed one that was to come and redeem Israel? Was he the one that was to come redeem humanity? But I have to tell you, before we cast judgment on John the Baptist, all we have to do is look in the mirror. That's right. You see, Mike Tyson famously stated after one of his boxing matches that everyone has a plan until they're punched in the face. And how many of you all know that pain has a way of getting your attention? Pain has a way of disorienting your faith. Oh, I know many of you are going through difficult moments. Right now, you have been figuratively punched in the face by life. The elasticity and the pliability of your faith is being challenged in ways that you have never experienced before. All of us, in some way or another, all of us are struggling right now. All of us are longing for streams of water in the desert. All of us are longing for some type of certainty in a season of uncertainty. But the one thing I credit John the Baptist with is that he wasn't afraid to ask Jesus the tough question. He didn't care. He didn't think about how he would be perceived. And I would encourage you, my brothers and sisters, that if you are struggling with your faith right now, if you are struggling with issues of doubt, call on Jesus. Ask him the tough question. How many of y'all know that there's no question too hard for Jesus? When things fall apart, when it feels as if the rug have been pulled from under your feet, remember that at some point or another, we all struggle with doubt, and it is okay. We all struggle with our faith. John the Baptist was as faithful and as real as they came, and he struggled. And my brother or my sister, I hate to be the bearer of bad news today, but there will be moments in your life, possibly right now, that you are struggling. When things fall apart, we all struggle with doubt. But the second thing you need to remember, saints, is that your doubt doesn't mean Jesus is not working. If I was in the country, I'd say your doubt doesn't mean Jesus ain't working. That's what I want to say. I will submit that at the root of John the Baptist's concerns and question was that Jesus wasn't moving like he thought he was going to move. Oh yeah, John the Baptist had served faithfully and fulfilled his role. And now, once again, he had been residing in prison for months, and maybe he thought his cousin Jesus would come and see about him. Maybe he thought Jesus was going to make things right. But Jesus wasn't moving as fast as he thought Jesus should have moved. He was expecting Jesus to do one thing, and Jesus was doing another. When was Jesus going to fulfill the hopes of the Hebrew Scriptures? When was Jesus going to reveal himself once again as the true Messiah and as Lord of all? When will Jesus, in other words, I think John was saying, when will Jesus move in the way that I expected him to move? So John's disciples went to Jesus with John's question. And what is interesting is that you never knew how Jesus would respond to a question. A lot of times he will respond to a question with the question. But what I found interesting in this passage about Jesus' response is that he never addresses John the Baptist's situation directly. Now, he didn't address him being on lockdown. He didn't address his confinement. But he instructed John's disciples to go tell him what they had seen and what they had heard. Go tell John about the ministry that I've been involved in. The blind see, the lame walk, those who had leprosy have been cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is preached to the poor. Go tell John that. Jesus' response wasn't pulled out of the sky. Brothers and sisters, Jesus' comments took John to what we know as Isaiah 35 verses 5 and 6, which paralleled other messianic passages in the book of Isaiah. It says, one day God will return. And this is what it says specifically, then the eyes of the blind will be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then the lame will leap like a deer and the mute tongues will shout for joy. You see the similarities between Jesus' response and this text in Isaiah? Yeah, he wanted him to know, in other words, John, I am who you thought I was. I am the Messiah. You are correct. I am the Holy One of Israel. I am the King of Kings. I am the Wonderful Counselor and the Bright and Morning Star. Ain't nothing changed, brother. I am who you thought I was. And that's how it is in our lives as well, my brothers and sisters. This might not make you shout this morning, but Jesus may not be answering your prayers or showing up in the way you feel like he should show up, but that does not mean Jesus is not working. All you have to do is open your eyes and look around you. Look at God's creation. Reflect on how the word is still being preached. Friends are being delivered. Co-workers are being healed. Families are being reconciled. Church members are receiving promotions. Others are being blessed around you. There'll be moments or seasons when things fall apart. But remember, because God hasn't moved, God hasn't answered a prayer in the way you thought it should have been answered, it doesn't mean that God is not moving. It doesn't mean that Jesus and the Holy Spirit is not alive and well, moving in this world. When things fall apart, you have to understand that you will struggle with doubt. We all have. Point two, Your doubt doesn't mean that Jesus is not working. But last but not least, I plead with you, saints, don't fall away. Don't fall away from Jesus. John the Baptist was going through a difficult time. Things have fell apart. And although Jesus didn't directly address his situation, he did let John the Baptist know he was who he thought he was, and he didn't have to question any longer. But without mentioning his name, he encouraged his cousin with some parting words. In verse 23, he said, "Blessed is the man who does not fall away on account of me." Oh yeah, Jesus wanted John to know that although things were looking bleak, although I haven't moved like you want me to move, trust me. Trust me anyhow, don't give up, don't fall away. Don't lose hope. Keep the faith, John. Stay encouraged and everything will be all right. And that is a word for us today. In the midst of these challenging times when things seem to have fallen apart and the weight of the world is upon our shoulders. This pandemic and everything associated with it is driving you crazy. It is slowly chipping away at your faith. It is beating you down. It seems like evil is getting the upper hand. But in like manner, I encourage you, like Jesus encouraged John, keep the faith. Oh yeah, stay focused. Stay encouraged. Don't fall away because of Jesus. But a matter of fact, you should run to Jesus. You should cling to Jesus. You should hold to God's unchanging hand and know that everything will be all right. And as I mentioned earlier, Jesus may not be answering your prayers or showing up in the way that you think he should. But I am simple enough to believe that if you trust the Lord, if you hold to God's unchanging hand, if you grow not weary in well-doing, if you only keep the faith, Jesus will walk with you. Jesus will talk with you. Jesus will encourage you. Jesus will strengthen you. Jesus will give you everything you need in this season of your life. And I know I have two or three of y'all out in virtual land know that if it had not been for the Lord on my side during those moments of difficulty when things were falling apart, I don't know where I would be. Oh yeah, he'll make a way out of no way. He'll continue to be a rock in a weary land and a shelter in times of storm. When things fall apart, he's still present. You're going to be challenged. You're going to have moments where you struggle with your faith like John. But remember, although he's not answering or he's not moving like you think he should move, that doesn't mean he's not moving. And last but not least, my brothers and sisters, don't fall away. Don't fall away from Jesus. Hold to Jesus. Keep trusting. Keep believing. Keep the faith. And he will be that glue in your life when things fall apart. And I'm simple enough to believe that he won't allow his children to struggle forever. And if you will only hold on, he has a way of putting things back together again. Be encouraged, my brother and sister. To God be the glory.
When things fall apart, when things fall apart, the preacher has told us that all we have to do is remember who's still in charge. You might right now be stumbling and falling. Your life might be crumbling. Things may appear, and they may actually be coming apart. But the word this morning is that in the midst of that, Jesus is still there. Jesus is still working. Someone outside the ark of safety this morning. You need to hear this word, and not only do you need to hear it, but you need to act on it. Mm-hmm. If you don't have your own personal relationship with Jesus, I'm not talking about your mom, your dad, your auntie, your grandma. I'm talking about your personal relationship we open up the doors of this great church and extend an opportunity for you to get right with God through Jesus Christ. You may come by letter, you may come by Christian experience, or you can come to be baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. But the most important thing for you today, if you're not baptized, enter into the joy of salvation. All you have to do is call us at 561-832-8338, and one of the clergy would be happy to talk to you about salvation. And there may be someone that gave their life to Christ in the by and by, but you don't have a regular church home. You've been going from pillar to post, and with COVID, maybe you've been sheltered down. But we invite you to join us. You can join us here at Tabernacle. And when we open up for regular worship, you can walk down these aisles again, and we'll bring you in. But in the meantime, just call us and say, I yield. I want to be a part of this great fellowship. I would love to be your pastor, and the good folk of Tabernacle would love to welcome you in to the fellowship that is here. And so again, think about it. Reflect. You don't have to struggle by yourself. There is a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul. And all you have to do is open up your mouth and say, I yield. Come out of the darkness into the marvelous sunlight. 561-832-8338. Amen. My brothers and sisters, once again, we come to that wonderful part of our service when we can bring our tithes and offerings into the storehouse. Amen, amen. God loves, let me say it again, God loves a cheerful giver. And I'm just so gratified by all of you who have continued, even in the midst of this pandemic, to be faithful to your church. You've continued to send in your tithes and your offerings, or you've used our website and our PayPal facility or the Give Life Fee to make your contributions. Or some of you, and we're always happy to see you, bring your offerings to Agape House. Just wear your mask and call to make sure someone is there to receive it. But again, I say it and I'll say it. If the Lord has continued to bless you, don't forget God. Sow into this ministry. To those of you who are visiting, you are welcome to participate. You may go to our website or you may mail your contributions to us at Tabernacle Church, 801 8th Street, West Palm Beach, Florida, 33401. You cannot be God-giving, no matter how hard you try. Whatever we have, it's only because of the goodness of God. And I can testify, when you cast your bread upon the waters, it does come back to you. And so bless the Lord, and he will continue to bless you. Let us pray. Oh God, here we are again with our tithes and our offerings. We've come to bring back a portion of what you have so graciously given to us. And now we return it back to you. And we give it to you joyfully. We pray, God, that you would take all of these offerings, you would multiply them, expand them, so they can be used for the continuing building of your kingdom here on earth. Bless every individual that has been so faithful with their tithes and their offerings. Bless that individual who really wants to give, but have not been able to because of circumstance. Bless them real well, Lord, that they might contribute to this offering. Oh God, we lift this up to you in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Hello, my brothers and sisters. As you saw earlier in this worship service, we commissioned our Justice Ministry team members, and we need four more. We're trying to get to the sanctified seven, I believe Pastor Kisner termed it. So once again, it's an important ministry. It's really about standing and being prophetic for the marginalized in Palm Beach County. But as a Justice
team member, you are really the glue here at Tabernacle, where you will be assigned certain members to keep abreast of what's going on and upcoming virtual meetings and what is happening with each particular issue. And, you know, you're just needed. We need more so that we can involve more of our members in this work. So once again, these individuals that you saw today, they need help. You know, we need others. So please, if you are concerned about the poor and about the marginalized and left behind in Palm Beach County, please give me a call at 561-832-8338. We'll love to have you help us lead this ministry. Thank you.
Amendment 4 changed the law in Florida by allowing people who had previously been convicted of felonies to vote.
It's fair, it's just, it's the right thing to do.
Voting now is more important than ever. We're having such important discussions on our streets and in our communities about racial justice, about criminal justice, about economic disparity.
As state attorney, I have said that we will not prosecute any returning citizen who in good faith registers to vote believing that they're covered under Amendment 4, because I want to err on the side of increased voter participation, not voter suppression.
If you have any questions about whether you're entitled to vote, please call our office. We have people waiting to help you, to navigate you through the process and get you eligible to vote.
My brothers and sisters, as we're about to come to the close of our service, a couple things I want to just remind you. A week from tomorrow will be the last day. It'll be October 5th. A week from tomorrow will be October the 5th, the last day that you can register to vote in Palm Beach County. My brothers and sisters, if you are not a registered voter, you know someone that isn't, you must try your best to plead with them and encourage them. This is critical. This year we see the kind of shenanigans that are going on up there in Washington right now. We need some righteous voting. And so you've got to get out and register to vote so that in November you can vote. If you haven't filled out your census information, please make sure you do that. And lastly, today on the 27th, there's going to be a wonderful special on CNN. Some of you may have seen my t-shirt, hashtag good trouble. That was a saying that John Lewis said about getting into trouble, good trouble, prophetic trouble. What we do it with the peace ministry. We need to shake up a lot of these systems. We need to trouble the waters with justice. And so we encourage you to watch that special on CNN tonight. I think it's about 10 o'clock, but you can check it out. But there's a whole documentary on John Lewis, who was a great man. Good trouble. We want to be good troublemakers.
My philosophy is very simple. When you see something that is not right, not fair, not just, say something, do something. Get in trouble. Good trouble. Necessary trouble.
He was always different than every member of Congress. Everybody knew what he had done. He was John Lewis.
We're marching today to dramatize to the world that hundreds and thousands of Negro citizens denied the right to vote.
Congressman Lewis gave us the blueprint to organize and to legislate.
The reason why he's effective as a leader is because he's lived it.
Troublemakers.
Montgomery.
Your order to disperse this march will not continue.
I was hit in the head. My knees went from under me. I thought I was going to down the bridge.
If John Lewis as a 19, 20-year-old wasn't doing what he did, I would not be here.
We will march with the spirit of love and with the spirit of dignity that we have shown here today.
The whole time he was in the movement, it was frightening, knowing the danger, knowing what could happen.
You cannot replace a John Lewis.
He's the most courageous person I ever met.
Too many people struggled and died to make it possible for every American to exercise their right to vote.
He challenges the conscience of the Congress.
Bring common sense gun control legislation to the House floor.
40 years later, John Lewis continues to inspire us.
Are you with me? Let me hear you. Three civil rights workers that were murdered for trying to help people get registered to vote are looking down on us.
This is a time for action. That's what I learned from John Lewis.
There are forces in America today who want to take us back, but we're not going back. We're going forward.
And lastly, the month of October that we're about to go into is for our 127th church anniversary. Yeah. God has allowed Tabernacle to be around for 127 years. Now, to be sure, we're not going to be physically together, but the anniversary committee is working on some exciting things that we can do virtual. They got some nice surprises that you can sew into, and you'll be hearing more about that as we get into the month of October. But we will still be celebrating our 127th year. We won't be physically here, but we're going to give God the praise and the glory that He's allowed us to be here for 127 years. So look forward, stay tuned. Look forward to seeing you on Tuesday, 6 o'clock, Bible study, virtual. And I'm still trying to get those 40 folk for prayer and praise service. We had 37 one evening, but we need the 40. We're going to pray this COVID virus away, and we're going to pray for some other good stuff. So please come on out, virtual, prayer and praise, 6 o'clock on Wednesday. And then Reverend Jones has his young adult Bible study on Thursdays and at 7 o'clock. So we want you to be involved. So stay tuned. We're still continuing to do ministry here at Tabernacle. We're touching those on the margins and a lot of good things. God has continued to be with us. And so we want you to stay faithful and stay strong in the Lord. Reverend, anything else you want to say? All right, let's prepare to get on out of here. Let's pray. Oh, Spirit of the living God, we just are so thankful that you're a God that even when we can't see you, that you're still working. Continue to be in the midst of us when things fall apart. Help us to keep our eyes focused on thee and to know that you are present and to not fall away even when the going gets tough. And now, God, as we're about to leave this sanctified place, we thank you again for this technological medium that allows us to continue to do ministry. We pray that you would continue to keep us safe from this dreaded virus. And those who may be infected, please, please bring healing. And God, keep all of us covered and protected as we are about to go back out into the world. And now, may the love of our awesome, gracious God, the peace of our risen Savior, His name is Jesus, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, abide, reside, and preside over each and every one of you, henceforth, now, and forever. Let all of God's children say, amen, amen, amen. God bless you. Stay safe. Have a wonderful week.
Where's all of my praise? I want everybody around the world to put your hands together because all the praise belongs to God. Here we go. God. Every praise.
God.
Y'all know how we do it. Take it up, give Him praise.
It's to our God.